Five, four, three, two, one, sync.
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 Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 228 of the TTV podcast.
Oh my
god! I'm Mesonak.
I'm Bartaran.
I'm Eljay.
I'm Jonathan.
I'm Takuma Nuva.
I'm Prpl.
And I'm Tenebrae Invictus.
And what the heck was that? Who did that?
That was the ghost of 2016 coming out. That's what that was.
Did you guys see that that horror movie trailer?
Yeah,
someone made it
2016, the movie.
It was really good.
I saw that.
I'm gonna need a link for that.
I will see if I can find it. Yeah. It was really funny though.
For any interested parties, this episode marks the first episode of the TTV podcast to be released for the new year of 2017, although it's technically being recorded on the 31st, so go figure.
Wow, just destroy the immersion there.
We don't have that fresh New Year feel, but you do.
Yeah, it's New Year's Eve, close enough.
New Year's on the other side of the world. I got a text from my family.
I mean, that's true. It's New Year's from some other people.
It is.
Yeah.
Weirdos.
How's everybody's new year going so far?
Kind of non-existent at this point. But,
yeah. Well, so far, so good.
Hopefully we'll pick up. Right?
Well, but guys, it's
Mardi Gras.
2017.
No one has died. That's cool.
So far, yeah, the first one dies on the first day.
You know what happened?
I mean,
statistically
speaking, people will.
So, there are... people will die. We had a tragedy this last week. Carrie Fisher... died, and her mother died shortly thereafter.
What, 2 days?
Great start.
Yeah, there was like a thing. I was reading Reddit, and after this news, people were like, well, you know, at least this is it. This is the last thing, you know, 2016 is coming to an end. And someone says, there's word that since Christmas, the queen has been ill.
No.
I don't know.
She has been sick for the past 11 days.
Right.
Man.
And so, like, the moment I read that, I'm like, Please don't make this like
we're gonna start 2017 strong.
That would be she is the longest reigning monarch besides the King of Thailand, and the King of Thailand died this year.
She's definitely older than the King of Thailand.
She was the longest reigning monarch. Second longest reigning monarch up until that.
Wow.
Point. Either way. That would be quite tragic. Let's hope that doesn't happen.
Oh,
yeah, I've been a lot of death this year. I've been reading up on all the celebrity deaths, and gosh dang, I hadn't realized just the slew. About roughly 112 this year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Dude, it's been a weird year.
It's been a very weird year.
Even with the trailer for the 2016, the movie thing that I watched, it was pretty all-encompassing as far as like the weird things that's happened in 2016. But even then, you would go through the comments, and there'd be people that are like, you forgot this, and you forgot that, and like someone mentioned, oh, you forgot the clowns. I'm like,
the clowns in there?
The clowns.
Oh my god.
It really has been a weird year.
clowns.
So much weird stuff.
I think like the thing that got me the most is that like so many things that people said that will never happen this year to an insane degree. Like, I'm originally from Illinois, right? Cubs don't win World Series. Are you kidding me? That's the longest running joke. The Cubs have not won the World Series since 19 whatever, like early, like almost over 100 years. Cubs have not won the World Series. Won it this year. Leonardo DiCaprio won an Oscar this year. You know, it's like how all this stuff that's happening. It's just it's crazy.
Yeah,
this
LG year was showing like, his insane. Face. Never gonna happen.
Brexit happened, and then the election happened this year.
Yeah, they forgot like, Brexit too. Like Brexit is like what.
No,
they did have Brexit.
They actually do mention that. Yeah.
They
actually,
You know, kind of the
Pokemon
other...
Go. Pokemon Go is this year. Do you guys remember that?
That exists.
No,
that was a huge deal in the U.S. for about
a month,
maybe 3 weeks.
Only three weeks, not even
Came
a month.
In only in the
I don't understand how they could have mismanaged it. Like,
no, they did it awful.
They never fixed.
Wasn't it just a small company who made it though?
Yeah,
not like
it was
a huge corporation.
When
small
they had that
Google
big of a
operation.
Breakout hit, if they had just remained like consistent with it and fixed some bugs, it would have like
not even that. Had they not been stupid and tried to do the real time like tap and swipe game, and instead done the actual Pokemon game that everyone knows and expects from the genre, they could have had everything. They could do multiplayer day one. All you have to do is send like this is how much damage this Pokemon did to that Pokemon. That's it. You just send that.
Totally right.
You don't need like a real time whatever stuff that they tried to do.
The AR thing they tried, yeah.
The AR thing was a cool idea, like going out in public. They just need to, like, if we could fight each other, that's the main thing that I would want. You know, like, have a full moveset. Yeah. I would have fought all of you.
Fighting other trainers is like the core of Pokemon, basically. So the fact that it doesn't have that is like
collect your own Pokemon. Why can't you fight with other trainers? That would be
pretty stupid.
You like indirectly fight other trainers with like the gyms, but like
Exactly. Like the gym, the way the gyms work was stupid.
Another thing. Also, Brick Fair. 2016. Yeah, Brick Fair.
We did that. We got to meet.
That's so great.
Pretty sweet.
Next year, Invi.
Sorry, Invi.
No. I mean, just that Eljay brings it up so much.
I know, right? What did you want
from me?
It was the.
It's like it was their first time they went.
It was momentous.
I think the thing that got me the most, like, out of all of you guys, I'm pretty certain that we'll cross paths, like, at least one more time, if not many, many more in the future.
But
Fleff was the one that I was like, I'm really glad I got to, like, meet her in person at least once. Because it might not happen, you know? It might never happen again. Visas are terrible. I was trying to work at, like, a work visa. Like, how much would it take to hire Fleff and have her work in the U.S.? It is a nightmare. Freaking Gavin Free has to go through, like, a bunch of stuff to prove he's qualified to work here. Like, Gavin Free, like, the guy who's, you know, the big British Swomo guys, Rooster Teeth, all that, they still have to go through this whole process.
Yeah, he's kind of little and British.
his nose is the biggest part of him.
Yeah.
So. I guess over here, he's Gavin, not free.
Wow.
Gavin at a price.
How ironic. In the land of the free, he's Gavin, not free.
BIONICLE also ended in 2016.
Yeah.
Was a major disappointment to us, I feel.
But
you know,
We were planning on BIONICLE going to 2017. That did kind of like put a damper on our plan, and we could see the writing on the wall a little bit. But the fact that they're like, you know, we thought that they were going to do just a smaller thing for 2017, not that they're going to cut it.
You know,
that changed a lot of what we were going to do this year, next year.
Also.
It sped us up quite a bit, so that was... Oh, and you know what else happened? Vessel got sunsetted.
Oh, yeah.
High noon.
Vessel did die.
A little over a year.
BIONICLE and Vessel. Like, the two things that were, like, you know, the core of our series. Two of our three
legs, practically.
Basically.
That's what it comes down to.
But, you know what? Through all that, even though G2 was a grand disappointment. Meso, I'm glad that you stayed so positive throughout its run. And you were a pillar of this group and this podcast every week during its
original
run. It was
tough, man.
Run.
It honestly was. But you know,
yeah, like, I can imagine, yeah.
When you're hit with adversity like that, you just gotta, you know, get your act together and get your head in the game and realize, you know, there's things bigger than you. You know? It's like, come on.
Yeah. But you know what? Good job, Meso. Thanks for lifting up our spirits and
thanks.
And making sure we didn't look on the bad dark sides of G2. You're welcome, buddy.
But you know,
especially considering there were so many of them.
There were quite a lot of them. But I will say that if there was a way to end 2016/begin 2017, I'm glad that we're getting to do it in the way we are going to do it this episode, because we promised last week that the coming episode, first episode of the new year, we'd be able to discuss the BIONICLE G2 art book, which was being sent out to the winners. And well, good news, it's here. For anyone who has not yet had a chance to look at it for themselves, BZ Power and BSO1 were kind enough to upload high quality versions of the art book to their respective websites for download. Links
and,
to both will be in the description below.
To clarify, they're not scans, they're the original digital versions.
Right,
they are. They
oh, cool!
The highest quality.
Like I can zoom in on this, and it still maintains the quality.
And it's quite sick.
It is amazing.
So, point being, they're completely able to browse. So, what I recommend with you all, when you're listening to this episode, if you can queue up the art book alongside this episode, because we'll be discussing a lot of stuff about it, probably in order, if I had to wager. So,
probably
you can just casually browse it along.
Oh, gotta whip out my physical one.
Oh yeah.
Oh, okay. Got
Do not wow. say it like that. Oh,
brag
God.
About it.
Bragging. So surreal.
Got my book right here. You can hear me tapping on it.
Yes.
Stop.
Yes, I mean,
you were
smart channel.
Is
you were the first one to
be jealous? Because I'm really not jealous.
You were the first really one cool to, like, openly post the art book pictures to, like, the Bionicle public.
You lucky son. You were able to sneak in there right before they posted the actual high-quality video and snag, like, 100 people who are like, whoa, real quick. That was good timing on your part. I mean, you earned it. You earned the art book.
I just wanted to share the pictures.
Here's the thing. Yeah, I did find out that people have had this copy for, like, a week.
Yeah.
And they wanted to wait until... they knew that people had gotten the winners had gotten their art books to post them, so
yeah. Quite right.
So good for them. So, it was really really cool there.
For those wondering how we're gonna do this, the Bionicle art book is comprised, I believe, of three different sections. I believe the first one, I'm not sure the order of which they're in.
The first one's locations. Then there's heroes, and there's villains, and then there's animations, like the 2015 animations, and then Journey to One.
Cool.
Ew.
And there's a bunch of different types of concept art contained within this book. There's, like, the kind we're familiar with. It's just, like, a sketch kind of a deal. But then there's also concepts from the 2015 animations, Journey to One, like Var just said. All sorts of stuff. There's mask designs and whatever. There's location designs. So there's a lot to discuss.
Yes.
Indeed there is.
So right off the bat, one thing I do want to kind of point out that I didn't really notice until now. The Art of Lego Bionicle, published by Makuta Prints.
Yep.
Yeah.
What?
I was talking about that. Also, first and only edition. I thought that was pretty funny. Man.
That was pretty great.
I love it.
Yeah. Thanks, Lego, for not screwing this one up.
Oh, yeah. Come on.
Out of all the things coming out
from Bionicle, this is the best, like, this is the penultimate thing.
I legitimately love every part of this. I love everything about this book. It was late. They did still kind of screw up the printing process, but I mean, like, that's kind of out of your control. But
the actual book came
the
out,
actual
right?
book itself is really, really well done. So in fact, honestly, the book, like, that the physical book is actually really, really well done, too. The quality of the printing is really good. The quality of the cover and the materials used is really good. So they did a great job with actually making the book.
And isn't yours signed, Var, by all of the people involved?
Yeah, I believe all the contest winners, their books are signed. So.
Sweet. Yeah. We also found out there are only 100 in existence. So, Var, you have which number?
The fifth one. 5 out of 100.
That's prestigious.
Mm-hmm. That's pretty great. Yeah. It would be great if you got the third one, you know, because we're the three there to choose.
Oh, my gosh.
Like, wow. This is also good.
Maybe you can trade it with whoever has number three.
My favorite thing about the location section, just, like, seeing the world of Okoda, like, represented in such vivid detail is really nice. But my favorite little Easter egg thing is the pictures of, and Navar posted this out on Twitter, little pictures of the masks on the pedestals. But this is from such an early stage in concept development, they use Hero Factory 2.0 heads. And that's significant to me for two reasons. That head hasn't been used since 2011. So I'm not saying this concept art is from 2011, but I'd bet that it would be. Otherwise, they would have used the Glatorian head, which came back in 2012, or the Brain Attack head, which came in 2013. So if that is from 2011, that's a long ways back that they actually had Bionicle concept art. And secondly, the second biggest thing, in those pictures with the masks on the pedestals, if you look closely, you can spot the creatures. And actual designs for the creatures as well. There's like Melum and Kitar and Tarak. And this begs a question, because Ryder Windham mentioned in an interview he didn't know of the creature's existence until he had already written the first book.
Huh.
Well, a little bit of timeline inconsistency.
Well, I feel like...
Well, maybe he just didn't have access to all the concept
art.
Yeah,
he might not have known everything they were doing. They might not have revealed to him the plot of the second year.
Yeah.
That could have been a possibility. We don't know, like, everything that went behind building that book, so.
Totally. I just love all this artwork. It's just...
It is...
Yeah, I really love, like, scenery.
The locations in particular, they're, like, really, like, cool, for lack of a better word. They're so
Like, they're so detailed. Like, I really admire people who can draw, like, landscapes and scenery, like, this well.
I can't do landscape at all.
Yeah, yeah, no.
Those... And, like, the thing is that everything is so creative, I feel. Each place kind of has a bit of a distinct style to it. It looks visually pleasing. There's a lot more detail into this world than we were able to see beforehand. And that was my main complaint, is that we didn't have world building. We didn't know what the towns really looked like, you know, the different cities. Like, I had no idea what separated, you know, the jungle region of Okoto from the, you know, fire region or whatever.
What?
How? I don't even know what it's called. I have no idea what that's called.
You were right. Unfortunately, it's just a region. What, Alja?
No, never mind. Continue.
Yeah. No, it's difficult for me to, like, come up with concrete things to say about these locations, other than I just absolutely love them. I love them to death.
Yeah, like,
it
really.
It makes me sad that not more was done with the actual world of Okoto.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like there's potential here. These landmarks are every bit as cool looking as anything that Mata Nui had to offer. It
definitely
to be developed.
Yeah.
I look at the one for the jungle region, right? And there's a small thing with a lot of the huts and how they looked and like how they're like kind of grass domes, you know, and they're like perched on the thing. Love that. That would have been great.
Totally.
Imagine getting like a Mata Nui online game, but it's done in this painterly style.
Oh my god.
So that
would be amazing. Oh man.
I would die.
Cool.
Oh,
that would
god.
Be really cool. That would also be a crap ton of work. Oof.
Yeah, like seriously.
Telltale's Bionicle with a better engine.
You know what? I would go for that.
I feel like, I mean, not even just a Telltale style. Like, even the style that the Mata Nui online game had, where it was like 2D assets. These are all 2D assets. You can, like, you know, as long as you have a background, you can cut and paste, like, pillars in front of things. The characters would have to be way simpler. You know, they couldn't really go into the detailed art style. But
just use
honestly,
the original sprites from Monog.
Right, but, like, I mean, honestly, like, some of this, just repurpose some of this art, I guess. It's like, some of this stuff is so cool.
I mean, when you think about it, like, this is basically, like, Monog of 2001, but in, like, just paper format. Image format
right,
instead of it being interactive, because the only thing that we don't have right now is context. That's the only thing Minog really brought to the table.
We don't have like a storyline.
Yeah, a storyline to put on top of it. Yeah. That's really all. So
the one thing I like about the Earth region too, like it looks like a lot of it is Onikoro is underground. This is kind of like in a giant cavern, and there's like things built into the walls of the cavern, and like all of these like passageways and pillars jutting out of it. Like that's really cool. That's
a lot
really
more like Metro Nui in this instance.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is.
Exactly. I would have loved to see more of that. Water region's also really cool. The underwater, like, temples, you know.
Well, when scrolling down through the location section, and it's really cool to me, they basically have concept art for everything. They've got all six of the region, the City of the Mask Makers, the City of Fire, Village of Fire, whatever. The Valley of the Maze. Well, I said the Valley of the Maze.
Amazing.
Whatever it's called, the Labyrinth of Control. They even have some for the Black Volcano and the Temple of Light, which I didn't really expect for some reason. But
they have
architecture
maps for the city.
There's an interesting picture a little bit above that. It shows a fire village. It's right next to the one of them at the beginning entrance of the maze.
Yeah.
And you see, like, this kind of spherical thing on a rope line.
Yeah.
In the fire village. Kind of reminds me of something.
Oh, I love that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's like the, what is it? I don't know what they call it. The shuttle to Kokoro, though?
Whatever goes over the Trenchrome break to Kokoro and Minog.
I mean, look at these huts. They're perfectly, like, ancient and also kind of technological, you know? Like, the domes on top are, like, part of the ship.
It's, like, they're similarly shaped to, like, classic huts and stuff, but they're made of, like, metal and stuff like that. So
you
it kind of combines the two different styles.
Lights right and things.
Fire. It's right underneath the, like, the maze, when they're doing the concept art of the maze.
It's on,
Page 13.
Page 13.
Okay.
Yeah. Honestly, those huts kind of look like they were modeled after Samus Aran.
like a Metroid hut?
Yeah, I get you.
I mean, I guess I can see what you're saying.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember seeing a post, I think it was by Ink here, talking about how all these locations are really well realized. It's just a shame that the line itself had to be construction-based, because it's really hard to represent this world building in set form. Whereas if it was a system set, we likely could have gotten these huts. We could have gotten some of these locations in more
can
of
you
a
imagine?
So what if Bionicle was a system set?
Can you imagine being a concept artist? for Bionicle and hearing all the fans go like, oh, there's no world building. And you're like, I drew that. I've done all this stuff already, but you can't see it.
Frustrating.
Like, how frustrating must that be? Like, to be like, oh, man.
Like,
I totally get you.
These pieces of art
and
that
I've
are
done
really,
that.
They're really impressing me the most is just this artist's rendition of the Labyrinth of Control and the Black Volcano. Mm. It just looks so indescribably epic. For lack of a better word.
I know.
It's so grand in scope and so distinct from everything we've seen before. It's a unique location.
This
it's
art,
varied. It's
yeah,
cool.
This art book almost tells more story than the novels did.
It almost does. It tells through showing.
This one picture you posted...
Which
one?
This one picture you posted of like the block floating with like the mask of...
Control.
Wow, I've already forgotten the names, man. Yeah. It's interesting because it's like a combination of painting and like Photoshop. Because like the side of this block is just like a photograph that's like edited.
Yeah.
In the perspective, but it has like the mask. Wow.
I forgot
the
term for that.
Mask painted on it.
There's an artistic term for that.
Matte painting.
No,
I think. Isn't it matte painting?
No, it's not.
I think it's steel painting.
I like it because it shows. It almost looks like the mask of control is sort of like forming on the rock too. Like you can see that there's like these like green lines going through the blocks, showing that it's the mask of control actually controlling this facility. But it almost looks like the way I'm kind of imagining it almost is like you know how like Makuta can like appear in shadow form like on different walls and stuff. I almost imagine this being a solid block, but where the Toa are, the mask is, like, keeping watch on them, so that it, like, forms through the stone, and it's, like, just looking at them as they're, like, going through the maze.
Ooh.
That's
so cool.
It's like in the Muppet Christmas Carol when one of the Marleys comes out of the door knocker.
Exactly.
I know exactly what you mean.
Definitely.
Old man.
You know what? Your face.
You're hip
okay?
and cool with the rest of us.
You gotta be hip to the jive, daddy-o.
Wow.
You know it, Gramps.
Well,
yeah.
Anyway.
One of the pictures that Var pointed out on Twitter that was very interesting is the one that just shows the Okoto landscape, but there's these weird circular structures with like a platform in the middle of the circles. And I don't know what... I feel those were probably supposed to be important.
They're stargates.
They're obviously stargates. So, we can figure it out. There's one of them in to the left, and we can see one definitely that has the T in the center, in the middle. It's two Ts. It's a reference to us. And the lava makes a V, it's TTV.
Oh my God.
You're right. Huh?
Okay.
there is a V in the lava.
Yep, they were definitely thinking of us back
V
in the day
was
when
sideways.
We
I mean, yeah, sideways
but
come on.
Represents our channel turning sideways when my uncle
oh, wow.
Oh my God.
But really, but no. Like, that's a cool, like, element of design that...
I don't know what the heck it's supposed to be, but I feel like...
Really great idea.
It looks really cool, though.
Because it's elemental symbols. It's like there's a staircase, and then the person's supposed to climb the staircase and stand on top of this elemental pedestal.
What if it was, like, some sort of big, like, elemental power channeling ring?
That's what I thought it was.
Oh.
So, well, basically what I thought it was. When I initially saw this picture, I was like, I wonder if
Stargate.
This... No, not Stargate.
That
well,
was
actually,
my first thought, but...
That was another theory someone had, actually, that it was sort of like a Stargate. But the way I saw it was...
Oh,
it's
like a previous universe? Like a
yes,
universe that existed
exactly.
Beforehand?
They're portals into a previous universe. Anyway, I was kind of thinking when I saw it, like, maybe this was... Since it's pretty close to the Makuta... volcano at the side there. I was thinking it was linked to Makuta, maybe. Like, maybe it was originally planned that... Or an idea of the Toa having to stand in these pedestals to fully channel the strength and draw it through the regions and then channel that towards Makuta to send him back instead of just, you know, being the elements.
That would have been very, really cool.
That kind of sounds
really cool. I would have been so down for that.
Six elemental Death Star lasers blasting.
Yeah,
right.
Basically,
dimension.
Yes.
No, it would be like a really, you know, at the end of Nog, that's how they defeat Makuta, but they all like do one elemental charge at him, and then they like.
Yeah, but here it would be like the entire region's elemental
entire
charge.
Like that's how they summon the elemental creature's power is through these rings, and they just like completely.
I'm imagining
destroy,
now a scenario
like
in
a Toa seal.
Makuta got reborn from the Shadow Realm as this giant Matanui robot-sized monster of shadow.
You're not that big.
And then Toa have to, like, go across the island to channel the powers, and it's almost like the island is fighting back against him as he charges up, like, this giant spirit bomb
It'd
be super cool, though. And shoots back up at him, and it would have been such a cool set-piece moment.
That would have been awesome if they did that in the second year, and then he just shrugged it off like, nah, boom.
And yeah, he killed everybody, and that's Bionicle ended.
Turns out that Makuta's real name was Lego.
Kimu into the Mask of Time and sends him like out, and then he goes and lands in the other universe.
Yeah. Just a lot of cool stuff here, though. It's just like that would have been an awesome ending right there.
That would have been really cool. I don't know if they're going to do it.
Like,
with it, but
even the page behind that, or a couple pages back, there's like these cool locations that I don't know what they're meant to represent, but they just look really cool and ominous, and I want to know more about them.
Yeah, like on page 31, there's like this one picture. It's super tiny compared to everything else, but it has like these giant lava monster looking things, like roaming around volcanoes. It's like, what is this and why isn't it bigger? Because I would totally use that on the wallpaper.
31.
See, yeah. this is incredible.
It's not page 31, Takuma.
It's 33.
Yeah, I'm looking at the PDF, 16 for
Yeah,
me.
It's at the bottom of 31.
Well. It is a miniature-sized picture on 31 at the very bottom of the page.
Oh, okay, yeah. I see. I wasn't following the page pictures, I was following the ones, like, for the PDF.
Yeah, I was looking at page 16.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, I get you.
I see. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, no,
it snowed recently, so it is icy.
So anyway, that's basically locations. There's some absolutely phenomenal stuff.
The water temple, man. That water temple is amazing.
Look, you know, as cool as the creature and character designs are for the rest of the book, the location part is probably my favorite, to be completely honest.
Because it's the only thing we never actually got, you know?
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And it's like cool characters. We got plenty of them.
I haven't actually gone through the rest of the book yet. I'm just kind of going as we go along.
That's perfect. Fine. I want to see your genuine reaction.
Yeah.
I feel like the world is definitely the thing that I felt was missing the most from YouTube. Mm-hmm. Like that was that's the thing that drew me to Bionicle, and it's the thing that kind of like kept me a bit skeptical about G2. I was like, I really want to see more of the world, and we're not getting that. And finally now we see all the stuff they had conceptualized.
It exists. It was there.
They just couldn't represent it somehow. Yeah.
Yeah. Nope. So I have a question for the art folk here.
Yeah.
So page 20. Or 38, depending on which one you're looking at. Heroes. We finally got this, like, big poster of all the Toa and, like, Lost.
Lost is a poster.
I gotta ask the art folk, because maybe they'd understand this better than I do, different perspective. Look over to the right at Liwa. What's his axe doing?
What on earth?
It's just floating above his head.
Could it be on his back?
But how?
Is it, like, connected to his shoulder?
I can imagine the axe hooking onto, like, the gear connector on his back, to where the bottom stick kind of, like, goes behind his back, and the top part of the axe goes above his head.
But where's the bottom stick?
Oh, so he's carrying it on his back? Yeah. That's a pretty big axe, though.
It is a pretty big axe.
Yeah,
I mean, realistic for the size on the set.
We look at the other weapons, though.
We can't actually see what his other hand is doing, but, I mean, from an art
perspective, it looks like he might be holding like another sword, because like you can see him holding a handle, and then it kind of extends out behind Onua's shoulder.
I think how he's holding his axe isn't really that important. This poster is mostly meant to be a concept poster of like what their designs would look like all together on one like page with this ominous backdrop thing going on. The idea here is because let me see. Who did this one? Okay, it's not a Matt Bedecker. Regardless, you can tell from the way this is composed is that the idea here was to get everything onto one page as quickly as possible. This is very much a very quick, rough cut of, like, how they envision a poster to be. In fact, this was probably made, and sent over to the marketing people so that they could go ahead and begin, like, composing actual advertisements, actual posters, sort of fit this style.
Yeah, probably. I just thought that kind of looked funny. Additionally, Kopaka's telescope's on the other side.
Gasp.
And he has a different weapon too, and he also like it looks for a bit like Pohatu's boomerang is actually also a staff. Because there's a handle kind of going through that as well. So no,
is that a handle or is it just Gally's leg?
Yeah, that's part of Gally's weapon.
It's part of Gally, because you see her weapon right behind it, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Death because it's like the poster we got in 01 or whatever, like the Toei just kind of, oh, they're just hanging out in a pose.
Yeah.
But there's this added element of Loss, like, wrapping his legs around the picture that I just think
I didn't even notice that. That's pretty sweet.
Okay, that makes sense now. Loss just wanted a hug.
You do realize when spiders die, they curl their legs inward, right?
Yeah, hugging Loss.
Oh my god.
Death was foretold all along.
We're going down, Loss.
Yeah, he's already dead in this picture.
I would say it's pretty likely that this piece was created on a single layer.
That's
probably why there's these weird oddities, like the lines going through and like the axe being a little misplaced.
Prpl, I was having such a good time. Look at
this guy's right there. It says the three virtues of Bionicle:
so bad.
Duty, unity, and destiny.
You had several different jobs. This was one of them, and you screwed it up.
I would like to hear the background behind that.
They didn't screw it. I think it's intentional that they reordered it. They did it so that it would fit with the 3-year plan that they had originally, where 1 year was duty, 1 year was unity, 1 year was destiny.
Didn't do that.
They never fulfilled like that idea, that concept they had, but they still retained the ordering of the three virtues themselves.
Envy.
This is an old joke, and it's so relevant. That's
true. But anyway, no positivity. As we move on to the heroes section, we see basically concepts of all the Toa, mostly the Toa Uniters.
Oh my gosh,
and their combinations with the creatures, as well as creature design concepts. This
Tahu,
is a really cool sequence.
Tahu_1. I love the Tahu Predator. I love that some guy was just like, yeah, you know what, let's give him dreadlocks. Why not? I'm an artist. I can do whatever I want.
There's so much cool stuff contained in this section. I don't even know where to begin.
Wait, which one does he have dreadlocks in?
Tahu_1. It's on page 30. Actually, it might be page 40, I think.
Page, quote-unquote, 21.
21/40.
It's the first concept page. It's to the left of Fire, the fusion weapon creatures, the gray one. And it's the top one to the left. In the center.
A small little picture. Hang on, I can push it.
Yeah, push it for me, because I'm not
push
seeing
it
this.
Push it real good.
That one.
Well, let's also talk about the three, like...
Oh, there it is. Okay.
Yeah, that one. So let's talk about the three forms of the creatures real quick. Because
It seems like they all have, like, a flying form, a not really rhino form, per se, but, like, sort of like
ability,
that ape-ish
armor,
type
weapon.
Thing. Yeah.
Ability, armor, and weapon, and I really like that was a consideration going forward, because it's meant to, like, and when you actually look at the sets in the end, that is what they went with as well. Like, there's two flights, two armors, and two weapons, even though Pahata is...
We don't like to talk about
it. Is Pahata supposed to be a weapon?
I presume. The stinger tail and, like, the claws, yeah.
You need to talk about Pahata.
Okay. So... There were a lot of concepts for Ketar. There were three in particular. He had a flight mode that was basically a carbon copy of, like, Uxar, almost. In spirit. And then they had the armor form, which was, like Prpl said, like a rhino kind of a thing that was kind of formed over Pahatu. And then
it's kind of like
really
a beetle.
Cool he had a really cool design that somebody's made a mock-up of, the stone slicer, which basically just gave him one giant arm with, like, a saw blade at the end. But the thing that I noticed about this was that Lego must have seen into the future with their completed Mask of Time that they withheld from everybody and realized that I was going to make a mock called Ultimate Omega Makutar.
Oh my god.
They use the exact design. Right down to the gears that come up from the center of the torso and extend at the wings and then the legs and then
you
the
tail.
You
need to post a picture, Meso.
Like a rip
I don't have a picture on standby. It'll be up in the video.
On. Back in 2011.
Yeah, exactly. They knew in the future that I'd make this stupid mock. But it really just, like, it kind of annoys me. Not that aspect of it, but just seeing how good Ketar could have been. But, I don't know.
Yeah,
you want to know what annoys me a little bit, slightly?
That you were so close to a Prpl dragon?
Yes! We were so close! to
I can understand.
Bionicle Prpl Dragon. That would have been like the greatest thing to shut up. That would have been the greatest thing LEGO ever could have done indirectly for me. And I just
Then you realize they didn't like you.
Yeah. I think like it was supposed to be more like a bat.
I mean, yeah, but it's thing.
But even still,
are you sure?
Those wing pieces are to die for.
Well, to be fair, the name Cave Flyer would imply bat.
Yeah, like I kind of think it's supposed to be a bat too, but I can always just say it's a dragon
element bat. Inspired by it too. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, remember every creature is a dragon combo.
These creatures are referred to at some points as I think creature exosuits. Yeah. One of the Tahu designs, it's referred to as a creature exosuit, which is kind of cool because they're being kind of like the Exotella, and also the creatures.
I love it because everyone actually, like, it evokes a much more complete feeling than what we actually got, which is understandable because it's concept art.
Yeah.
But it's just cool seeing how much better things could have turned out, like, if Parton's budget wasn't a consideration.
Well, I mean, like, it is a thing where I have zero idea how this would translate into an actual
set. Like, the thing about art is that you can just kind of draw in the gaps. You don't have to, like, fill it in with pieces or anything.
It would be a cool contest to have at some point to be like, you know, imagine, build a creature that fits on any of the United Toa. That also does all three of these. The creature.
All three or one of the three?
Yeah, I don't know about all three. Ability, what armor, you do weapon. Is you'd need to make three different creatures.
Well, I mean, that would be the thing that, like, I feel like the whole creativity aspect of it is I don't see how it could work. I wonder if anyone else could take up this challenge and see if it could work. I don't know if it could work, but, like, it would be cool to see if, like, that was possible ever to do three ability, armor, weapon, and also creature.
It is really interesting looking through these and seeing the different ideas, because some of them kind of overlap, like armors, the armors and the weapons, they, like, for Uxar, for instance, the armor version, or weapon version looks very similar to our weapon version for Onua, the Gatling guns, the claws.
And by extension, the flight looks similar too for Leela and Onua.
Yeah, exactly. So they kind of overlap at times, but it's interesting to see they got from here all the way over to what is, like, for me, behind my shelf. Behind me on the shelf. Dang it. And it's just kind of a drastic shift. And for Leela, for example, look, they gave, at one point, grappling hooks. Look at that. That's really cool.
Spider-Man. There's also, like, the thing he would have, like, fans, like, from a Venus flytrap. That's also really cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's perplexing, but cool nonetheless.
If we ever do make one of the characters female and it happens to be the Toa of Jungle and G3 discussion that's going to be coming up, we should consider that. I like the idea of having fans and, like, little
kind of like the Warriors of Kiyoshi.
Yeah, like the Warriors of Kiyoshi from Avatar. Yeah.
Nia from Ninjago.
Speaking of.
Oh, does
said
she?
Every other female warrior.
Speaking of Leela, though, what is that supposed to be?
Wait, that's Anua's mask. Or Tahu's. I can't tell.
Nah, it's Leela. It's like.
It's a Leela design, yeah.
Yeah, it's in the jungle creature section.
Perplexing. The idea is that, like, the creatures are supposed to. We see that now. The heads.
Yeah, that was translated into the set, actually.
It's Rooster Man.
Well, I kind of thought of it more as, like, a helmet than anything, not like a literal fusion of their skulls.
Right. But I mean, like, that concept was basically the one that made it through, unlike Anua's, like, you know, sawblade arm.
Oh, my gosh.
Speaking
of Leela. Back to the grappling hooks. If you look right below the, like, him swinging on the trees, isn't that an awfully familiar pose?
Which one?
Leela off to the left. It's the grappling hooks, him swinging through the trees.
Oh, I see
it. Right.
You tell
me. That pose, it reminds me of when we first saw the leaks, and we thought that one of the leaks looked a lot like Peruk, because it's that same generic pose.
You're right. I remember.
Been around since dirt.
Interesting.
Man, oh man. You know, there's a lot of cool concept art in the heroes section, and I like seeing how the creatures were translated to their various designs, but there's only one true amazing piece of art, and it's one of the best in the whole book, IMO. and it is obviously Night Tato.
Okay, yeah, that is actually really cool.
It is really cool.
Oh, man. That
one of
is...
the best.
I thought you were about to be sarcastic and post, like,
yeah,
some dumb
little
thing.
Yeah, I was expecting something.
The evolution of Night Tahu is just really cool. Like, you see you see default Night Tahu fighting the creature, and then you see them, like, combined, and it's just like, oh my gosh, that's so cool!
Yep.
My gosh, if he had had, like, dragon wings and stuff, oh my gosh.
Now, I can see if they had released that model, people would have complained that it had too much gunmetal. So what they did in turn was release a set that had too much gold. I don't really care. I don't know.
Yeah. The gunmetal like definitely this. Works in the artwork. I kind of wish that could translate to the toy set, the toy version, but I don't know how that would look, actually. Yeah.
The master version of Tahu is really cool. I like the fact he has the cape. That's a really cool feature.
They released that. That
they
cloth?
Did. Oh, they did that, release that!
That is a poly bag.
Yeah, they released the cape!
Yeah,
I didn't know that.
Wait, what? Oh.
I'll go get a picture.
Yeah, it was
a
Mask of Creation polybag that had a similar looking
No
cape.
Way.
It was completely non-canon, of course, but it still merits mention, and I'll go get it. One moment.
Also, RIP. That picture was just a really cool... It told me many things. Number one, they had a better looking version of the crystal piece that was in design that I wish they'd went with. It just looks much cooler to me. The staff was actually an idea, and it wasn't an implication by the toy designers like some people thought it was. And also gold Vorox armor. Yeah, there's
Oh, that yes. one. Okay. Yeah, I never got that polybag.
Okay.
Yeah.
Neither did I.
Never sold publicly, like in the U.S. at least.
Dude,
yeah,
that's
no.
That's so cool. They actually did give him his cape.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Well, okay. Obviously, a pure, perfect example of how something can look really, really cool in drawings, but not translate all that well to an actual toy.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
And for anyone who's going to ask, I'm not reviewing it. Don't ask.
Just review the cape itself. That's it.
Yeah.
I want to know if it's a good cape.
Here's the one thing that I feel is missing from this art book. They have two amazingly well done drawings of Liwa and Gali at the end, just in their master version, which are great.
Oh, yeah.
And I wish they had others for the Toa as well. Just the other Toa. Like, there's only Liwa and Gali, and there's a small Tahu at the bottom right of Gali. So, like, it would have been really cool if we could see the others as well. I don't know if they had, like, a page quota in the book they had to meet or something, but I would have liked to see those in full glory as well.
Speaking of those pictures, to bounce off what you were saying, Var, some things that look good in concept don't always translate over to the sets. That Liwa, that's Uniter, which is perplexing because the one on the right is Gali Master. That Liwa Uniter has the exact same amount of green pieces and green representation as the actual set. The set looks like it hardly has any green at all.
Yeah,
it looks mostly silver, but this looks great.
Yep, it's all about shading and how stuff is looking, really.
Yeah.
So Gali has a really good pose, though, with her, like, her fins in the water and stuff.
Yeah.
Honestly, I feel like out of all the characters that got a really great redesign, Gali has the most iconic redesign. When I think of Gali now, I don't think of her 2001 version. I do think of her master version. Especially
agree.
The mask. The mask is
like a lot more personality.
Way better. Yeah, a lot more personality, way better fitting for that character.
The Gali master set was a masterpiece. It was really well good.
Yeah,
it was one of the best.
I love the owl creature. Just like a random comment. He just looks so cool. Huge.
Yeah.
I legitimately wish that he had turned. Yeah, Tarak had turned out to be more of an owl type build.
Yeah, I do too. I kind of wish the creatures were a bit more unique in their animal designs rather than all just being dragons.
Dragons.
Like
one
of the concepts for Melum made him a straight rhino, like on four legs and everything, and then on the actual set he's just like some bootleg Tarak clone. And I'm like, come on, man. Could have done something better.
Yeah, it's a little meh. But, I mean, once again, translating the concept to sets. Actually, it's probably something we should probably address because I feel like there's a lot of comments out there right now that I think for the most part people are pretty positive about the book. There's a lot of negative comments about how, like, oh, there was so much potential and Lego didn't go with any of this and any of that,
yeah.
And I can't believe
really
they squandered the talents here.
I'm seeing long conversations about the art book, and yeah, you're totally right. Some people are being quite negative, but it really did strike me there was a discussion on Eurobricks being had, and it was like some people were saying Lego ruined the concepts. They didn't properly translate them into the sets. This is proof that they didn't care about Bionicle. And then someone replied and said, no, there's the concept art in this book. It's proof that they did care about Bionicle because there's concept art. And I'm like, cool down. It's concept art.
Yeah.
Yeah, like all concept art is like visual brainstorming. Like you just have to get the ideas out there and then figure out how to work with
them. Everything is concept art. It's not evidence of anything.
Concept.
Yeah, unfortunately, I don't think a lot of people understand what concept art actually is. All of the artwork in this book is very, very early stage stuff. This is stuff that they used when they were like, okay, we got to bring Bionicle back. I have no clue what that's going to look like. They just got a team of artists all around. They all brainstormed art. They all did things, cool ideas, anything that came to their heads. They drew down, they jotted down.
Literally, it was like last week, except if we were all artists and we all drew instead of talking about what was happening. This is exactly it. We're just like, you know what would be cool? What if we had like a creature that was three things at once? And also, if it like merged with, you know, the dragon and then it was like a
what if Tahu was a knight? What if he had a cape?
If Tahu was a knight, would he have a cape? You know?
Yeah, it's just
a lot of what ifs. And then like
literally
the people
all this book is.
Pick what will work and what won't. Yeah, from it.
I think a lot of people are assuming that the sets are direct translation
actually,
of the artwork. But that's not the case.
I'm thinking specifically of, it's been forever since I watched this, but there's for Star Wars Episode 3, some of the behind-the-scenes stuff, I remember watching this segment where literally they're trying to figure out what General Grievous is going to look like as a design.
Yes.
And so they had this whole, I don't know if any of you guys ever watched it.
I have watched that segment, the behind-the-scenes of Revenge of the Sith, the General Grievous artwork,
the
in fact.
Of.
The making of this is literally the reason why I want to become a concept artist. That's the
I
very
really
first behind
that.
Yeah, the very first behind the scenes video I saw. Anyway,
there's just hundreds of designs plastering like a cork board or something, and some of them are just completely off the wall. I remember there's one where he's like this little, like almost, you know, sort of stereotypical big headed alien looking baby thing in a throne.
Is it?
Or
is
the
it
one
this
that
one?
Really spoke to me, or I guess one that really stuck out to me was one guy said he was like in a bathroom or a closet or something, and he saw like one of those spray bottle heads. It's like, oh, if you turn it up so that you're looking down at it from the top, it looks kind of like a head. And so that was another concept that he built on for General Grievous.
I have so
oh my
many
gosh
artworks.
Yeah, that's the picture. Okay, maybe it didn't look as alien as I remember, but this I've watched
this
so
many
times.
Still like
ago.
It's still really weird, right? It doesn't look like General Grievous at all.
Yeah,
it looks a bit more like Thrawn, honestly. You know, like
I mean,
baby Thrawn.
Yeah. It does.
Basically, the thing for me is, like, I collect a ton of art books. I love collecting art books. I actually recently just picked up the art of Rogue One, which is on sale at Barnes & Noble. And it was, like, $20, and I was like, I gotta get this art book. So I have so many art books and so many concept art stuff, and you can see, especially with film, how much it's weird to see something develop from concept art to what you see on screen. The art of Episode 7 is the same way, where it's like they had a concept that Darth Vader was going to be in the movie, and he would be like a Force ghost, and his ghost would change from Anakin Skywalker into Darth Vader and like back and forth, and they like drew some like weird stuff to like convey how that was, and that's just part of like the process. When you're brainstorming, you pitch it to people, and then they concept artists are supposed to just whip it out as fast as possible, give it to someone to see, and they're like, oh, I get you now. That's what you want. Well, we can't do that. Props is like, we can't build that, you know. That's not going to work well in CG. That's not going to work well in whatever.
I can't wait till this art book goes on sale.
Concepts are conceptual, so I think people really need to take a step back and realize that this artwork was not necessarily meant to translate exactly as it's represented on page. And there's a lot of limitations when building a toy.
I love reading into stuff as much as the next guy, but this art book has no relevance in the discussion of did Lego care about Bionicle.
Yeah, it really
It's one thing to be disappointed that something wasn't a set, but like actually saying whether or not Lego cared about like their own line
That's
is a bit
stupid.
Extreme.
Yeah, and it's also like a thing where like they could have gone, I mean, we were talking about the Makuta instructions for a while and how they didn't release anything. They could have just released this PDF, but they went out of the way to do the hardcovers too, so that people had a physical thing, like, you know, a cool collector's edition.
Honestly, is it hardcover or paperback?
What?
Is it hardcover or paperback?
Oh, that's a good question. Is it hardcover?
It's hardcover,
He was knocking on the hardcover earlier when he was talking.
I mean,
yeah,
they could have just been his table.
Could have been knocking on a paperback.
He could have been knocking on wood. You don't know.
Honestly, like, if this art book has done anything for me, this is the first time I've ever felt like I need to write G2 fanfic.
Because now we have something to write about. Yeah, now I'm
There's
like, okay, I can envision them in this
that was,
place.
That was my whole thing for G1, besides, you know, the webcomics that we all did, was was the storytelling, and now I feel like I can actually do that with G2, albeit with, you know, a sort of an alternate art book timeline approach.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
I want to write about this soul grinder.
Yeah, every story needs a good villain, which brings us to the last section. Villains.
Wow, Meso.
And soul grinder is a great way to actually intro that section. Although, my personal favorite pictures are the ones directly below it. Picked a cool battle with Lost, and we never got to see where he had like all the Matoran in cages, like in the sky.
Yeah,
the
Matoran? That is cool.
Yep, Matoran. Club confirmed.
Okay. All right. Fine. Yeah. Also, how cool is that? You're talking like... about. I don't see Soul Grinder here. I only see Vermilion from Ninjago.
Yeah, he basically is the Dawn of Iron Doom. Man, that's an interesting thought.
So Skull Spider is kind of like does the same thing as Makuta did in 04. Locks all the Matoran in these little pods made of webbing and strings them from the sky. That's a really cool
image. That, again,
cool
is just
image.
Such a cool
that's
visual
That's a cool visual,
image.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And it's as compared to the actual Lost battle we got with him on a bridge somewhere. So, go figure. Wait, Var, have you never seen this concept art before, the early Toa?
No, I'm making a
what?
Joke.
Oh, okay.
You transitioned before I could post it.
I've never seen that before, actually.
Yeah, I was about to say, so, like, I linked a picture of the early Toa concept art from Bionicle G1, where they all had animal heads and stuff, and they're really ugly looking and everything. I was just thinking, what is this? How come LEGO didn't directly translate the sets to this? They didn't care about Bionicle G1, guys. How come Liwa didn't have a shark head?
Yeah, I know, right? Jungle missed shark. Opportunities.
No,
think about what kind of a mask I could have been wearing this whole time. Oh
my gosh.
Wouldn't that be interesting?
So yeah, that just goes to show you how much concept can change from just the artwork to the actual set itself.
Oh, totally. And also, sometimes concept art can just be, it's because they have such freedom, it would be impossible to actually translate it into a figure, no matter how hard they tried.
Right.
Case in point, this dude... the hooded cloak guy with like the staff that has like the string in the center.
He looks
how
like
would they
some
have
kind
done
of
that?
Witch doctor.
I mean,
it wouldn't happen, especially the weapon. That's like,
I could
no way to make that.
I still kind of see
like,
that.
Yeah, they have
like,
a pattern in Ikimu's shield that's kind of like, you know, like if they had just kind of done
the thing to consider
like,
isn't
they make
so much
spider webs as Lego pieces, so I could definitely see them doing the string thing.
I'm interested by the staff that seems to throw bolas. Like, I don't even know how that would work.
That's impossible. That's the what's it? The Gotorian thing. What was it called? You know what I'm talking about. The line
that
they have.
You're thinking too limited, Meso. It doesn't necessarily have to be a Zamor. But with that said,
I'm just making a point. Like,
I don't think the point so much is that this couldn't be adapted. I think it really well could be. I mean, they've got an element for the hood. It looks kind of cool in artwork. Might not look that cool in person, but it still could be done. I think there is more limitation to it than just could we do it. It's also the fact that you have to work with a certain amount of piece counts. You have to work with a certain amount of new elements. You have to be able to make sure that those elements can also be used for other themes outside of just Bionicle, too. Because that's the whole point of CCBS, was that it was like easily adaptable and moldable and could work with system, right? So
Didn't they mention that in an interview recently?
Yes, they did.
Okay.
There's an interview in a New Elementary, actually, that has a lot of these limitations listed out.
I haven't read that yet.
Yeah, it's really good. It really kind of clarifies why some of these sets might look really, really cool from a concept point of view, but not so much on a set point of view, because there are limitations when developing them. You do have a budget to work with. You do have a limit to work with.
You have
another
to also
case in point, Umarak the Octopus.
I mean, like, part of it is, like, you know, how much will this thing sell, too? Like, sometimes they might be like, all right, well, we have to look at these colors because these sets don't really sell if they're in this color. And we have to redesign this. You know, there's a lot of other things going because the end result is to make toys that sell. And so sometimes kids don't like certain things. Sometimes kids don't like cloth, for example.
I think really the better way to look at it isn't so much that the art book, all these concepts are things that LEGO squandered or wasted, or these are all examples of why no one cared about Bionicle. It's more so a look. Meso, you mentioned this before. It's more like a look into what Bionicle could be if it wasn't a toy line, if it wasn't shackled to having to be represented as buildable action figures.
I love it to death because of that. It's so refreshing seeing that.
So,
and like even the skull villains, they have art of all the skull villains, and they look accurate to the sets. These were obviously later down the line of concepts that were being shown here, but they all look better. But they're the same sets, but it's because it's artwork and not like the actual toy, you know? You don't see Skull Scorpio's technicky tail with the function, you just see a cool-looking tail.
Yeah, it still looks kind of meh, to be honest.
It's hard to say, because I definitely see, oh, yeah, that's still kind of a nasty tail, but since I've already seen it in real life, it's hard to say, you know? I can't look at this with new eyes.
Yeah,
I can see quite clearly because like the legs are bent; they're not like pre-bent on the toy. There's like a lot of things here that are like, yeah, this is just what the artist would have had Skull Scorpio look like.
And it's exactly the same as the set.
Legs don't bend in the set, Eljay.
I know. I've complained about it ad nauseum. But yeah, I don't know. I still see the same old sets. I guess Eye of the Beholder, I suppose.
So, is Skull Grinder cutting Pahatu in half or what? See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Or what? I think it's an illusion.
Wait, where?
I don't think it's Skull Grinder, but yes. I mean, it does look he's cutting Pahatu in half, for sure.
Wait, which page are we looking at?
That one.
Just scroll down a little bit more.
Oh, okay, there.
Yeah.
Oh, it might not be Skull Grinder. Like, it looks similar a little bit to, like...
Color
it looks
scheme,
like,
yeah.
Yeah, well,
it looks
like
a completely new one.
It looks like he united with the weapon creature or whatever, like... To get
does
the
he have
guns
the waist swivel gimmick?
Yes, he does.
I think he does. That's awesome. Man, so many cool villain concepts.
I like this picture a lot, mainly because Pahatu deserved it.
Oh, man. Yeah. Like, I look at like the kind of... I'm not sure if that's metal glowing hot as it's cut in half, or if it's like blood or what, but that is one very...
metal.
Very gnarly.
I saw it as like metal that's just hot because like in the front there's like a rock that's being split open too, and it's like also kind of hot.
Oh,
so.
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Umarak has so many cool concept designs.
You know, I'm not
gonna
lie.
So many of them.
I almost feel like I like the Umarak set more than the concept art. I think this might be
likewise.
Like one of the few exceptions. Because Umarak is such a good
set. The actual
set.
Yeah, like that
it makes me
first picture
the set even more.
You posted. He's like mostly gray and green, almost like Liwa. But
yeah,
in his
he's
got way
Xbox
more colors, and it
Hunter.
Looks way. Oh my god, he looks way better.
Totally.
I would say, man, I'm looking at some of the other beasts. The Demon Warrior is a really, really interesting design.
Oh my gosh,
the
I
Demon
want it so
like
bad.
The lime green and the almost pinkish, not even purple. I think.
Yeah, it's looking very pinkish.
Purple, but it's like a very pinkish kind of like
magenta.
Sure, but like that whole design is something I don't think I've seen in a while, especially not in Bionicle.
I want that oversized shield piece.
Yeah, that looks.
People
like,
would hate it for being
combo.
Specialized, but I want the heck out
but
of it.
I love how it's also a shield and a sword at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
That's such a cool design.
Shield weapon combo.
I just realized the pictures of the skull villains you guys were looking at, and you were like, I don't know, I don't really see the set. Oh, I do see the set. These actually aren't character concepts.
They're box art.
They're box art concepts. Yeah.
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 Oh, does it actually say that?
No, you can just tell if you look at them.
Yeah,
the poses.
Yeah, they're
the
exactly the same poses as they are in the box art.
Yeah, box art concepts.
Oh,
so the sets were likely on a finalized area by the time
exactly.
these were made.
That's right. These are just to show what they should look like on the box art. And if you we compare
I miss one thing.
The box art, you can see it.
I had a question that I missed because I posted the octopus Umarak picture, which was fascinating to me. But is that supposed to be Lava Beast?
Mask
right?
Snatcher? Or
no, on the Umarak Octopus picture.
Oh.
A beast that has Lava Beast's hands, but more importantly, the fire claws that have the two blades sticking out.
Oh,
I'm not
maybe.
Sure if
yes.
it's actually supposed to be Lava Beast.
Yeah, I think these were meant to be the beast over there on the right.
Man.
Huh. Oh, man. Bionicle Cthulhu. He could have been
right?
real. Oh man, that would have been so
Bionicle
awesome!
Kraken, Bionicle,
imagine him
Jones,
like rising him from like rising from the sea, and he's the tentacles, and like the mask itself has like you know it's like has the like connectors you can move the tentacles around and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Like he's like freaking Davy Jones from Pirates of the Caribbean or something.
That would have been incredible. So I know the answer is pretty self-explanatory. Just another villain concept, but I'm sticking to my dark Kopaka.
Oh, black ice Kopaka.
Yeah.
Shadow Kopaka.
Oh, Black Ice Kopaka.
Black Ice.
Black Ice
is a
lookout for
Black Ice is
dangerous
dude.
Black Ice.
Black ice is dangerous. You just don't
know. I know. You see about it.
I can't see him at all.
It just slips up on you.
Yeah.
I just love it. Love it to death.
Okay, so in the picture next to it, it kind of looks almost like a Lava Beast concept, but I found it interesting how he's using, like, Tahu's mask as shoulder armor.
Yeah.
Like, right there.
And specifically that sort of that it dropped when he got his golden mask. So it's like, what was... So my question is, why is there a point in going... Did they just find it, or was it... I'm not articulating well today. Why go out and get his abandoned mask?
Because it's
mask,
mask
I'm assuming
snatcher.
Mask snatcher just likes taking masks.
Yeah, but yeah, I feel like I feel like he would try to snatch them from people who actually own them and not just scavenge. You know, actually snatch
yeah.
them.
I mean, it's like
oh,
I'm
this
money
is a
snatcher,
Toa's
right?
Mask.
Like, I could snatch money from someone's wallet, but if I found a dollar bill on the street, I'm going to snatch that money too, you know? Like,
that's not really snatching, though. That's just reappropriating. I don't know.
Forget yeah, same thing here.
Sure.
Also, somebody pointed out his head looked exactly like Corroder's from Hero Factory.
Corroder?
Oh, yeah.
Like a hammer.
Well, I mean, that makes sense, because I believe a lot of these artists also worked in Hero Factory, so.
I mean, it also makes sense that they're, like, they're wanting to reuse pieces. Like, they have that in mind. Like, hey, what if we reused this piece, this mold, and gave it a different color or something?
We've made our way down to what is probably one of my favorite pictures from the whole book. And that has to go towards, as Var so aptly put it on Twitter, and I'm probably going to butcher pronunciation, Neon Genesis Bionicle, or whatever he said.
Yeah.
The incredible battle royale of whoever the heck these two people are versus each other.
This is a fascinating example of what is clearly just a cool idea that someone had that would never actually translate to the actual line.
Well, okay, yeah,
so,
like, so
many things in these in this picture. I don't even know where to begin. There's like spinning
it's like
top people.
Werewolf Tahu versus Umarak the Beyblade Thrower.
He has a fire axe. And the, this is almost like if you went to Japan and you gave someone like a couple pieces of concept art about Bionicle, and they're like, "Can you make a manga about this?" And he was like, "Sure," and he drew this. It's exactly like that.
I would be so down for Bionicle.
Oh, but like
this.
Here's the thing
there's
that
like
makes me think
temple
it.
On the left.
The temple on the left. It's like a pagoda. That's like the fire temple, and it has a
and
fire thing shooting in the sky.
Nice.
And then like the, and also the humans that are running away. What?
Bionicle.
What?
Yeah.
Like a bunch of ninjas
what?
Running off.
What is the pedestal in the background supposed to be, do you wonder? Because it looks almost
stuff.
Like an early concept or something along the lines of the Mask of Ultimate Power with like six elements, six prongs.
Yeah,
six
I think it's probably
true.
You can see
is.
You can see like these gates with like elemental symbols on them, like lightning or something like that. So I feel like it was supposed to like be a jail for the mask. Like it looks like it's supposed to come together like in a ball and then it expanded outwards and then the mask is up there like, you know, with the six beams or whatever.
Hey, look at me, I'm getting free. Beyblade.
Yeah.
There's also like two masks like below where the pedestal is. You can see like two masks that kind of look interesting.
Like up on pillars.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It is
right,
really yeah.
Like an arch gateway.
It looks like
honestly,
it could be the combined Vahis or like a Voki concept.
Yeah,
almost.
It looks kind of like
maybe.
An Voki.
I mean like okay, let's be real. Look at all like these the creatures are fighting and then the humans are running away. This is basically like Pacific Rim more than it is just Bionicle. You know, it's like these are very clearly supposed
yes,
to be humans,
please.
I feel. I can't really imagine them being anything else.
It's one of the coolest Bionicle like pieces of art I've seen, because it's just so different from what we've
yeah, it's
done.
Like, imagine Bionicle, like, it's this ancient tribal world, and these futuristic robots crash down, and they start, like, warring over, like, and talking with the humans and stuff. That's a radically
now we gotta
Bionicle.
Discuss, because Var also posted this on Twitter, community, figure out what this set of images is supposed to represent.
Oh my god, just use a poosh, you don't need to upload each one.
Oh, fine.
Do you mean?
Yeah, geez, Prpl.
Just do
we
it.
Do this. What the heck this is supposed
this is
to
a
represent.
Podcast.
I don't actually know.
Okay.
If I had to take a guess. It obviously has something to do with summoning the Toa, but
I
don't
I,
know
I got
what
an
exactly
idea.
They're trying to
okay,
do.
Okay,
right.
Let's all
can
hear
I just,
let's all
can I throw
theories.
In one thing quick?
Okay.
No. What if these rings are the same ones we saw earlier on the landscapes?
Wouldn't that be interesting?
Interesting.
I will now let it to you guys. Before I say anymore.
Well, on the one picture, the person raises a mask to the sky, and then six things from the sky come down to the mask, or...
Or being shot out from it.
Yeah, it's a little hard to tell. And then the second picture, what looks like villagers are coming down to look at the mask, or the Toa are being dropped from the sky via their stars, six Toa. And then in the final picture, it's clearly supposed to be villagers, though, because I can see the protector helmets, masks, whatever. And then they're raising their hands up to the sky, sending their energy out.
Notice what that the six dots are still there, though, just they don't have lines going to them.
Yeah, what if the circle is the black hole from the volcano in earlier concept art?
Wouldn't that be interesting?
All right, I'm gonna give you an idea.
No, I believe that actually, because in the first picture it has Makuta's eyes right next to it, and then in the last picture they're sending energy up to it probably to stop Makuta.
you guys are gonna be like, come on, it's kind of for fun, kind of just spitball it out there. Here, in the beginning, Makuta was there, and he died. There was one Matoran who built the Mask of Time. He became a Turaga with six other people, and then they sent all the six original Toa through a hole in time to come out in another universe.
Who is this one Matoran?
Well, it was Vakama.
Vakama
built the Mask of Time, and then they became Turaga, and then they sent the Toa through this thing, and that's exactly why.
I think I got a better idea.
What if the G1 universe was going to, like, absolutely go to pieces, so they just said, we need to have, like, a final Hail Mary, so they send the Toa to a safe alternate dimension, so that when everything goes boom, they live to come back?
I got the answers.
Which is terrible, because it connects G1 and G2.
Four pictures, right? Okay, the first one, it has those, like, shadows in Makuta's eyes. Well, that's actually Wolverine, and he really doesn't like the
and
color red.
And instantly lost him.
Not even come up with good biology.
And then in the second picture, it's a guy with a mask, and he's trying to wash it in the rain.
Okay, let's move on. Unfortunately,
the mask fell into like a well.
No, all right.
So they tried to send all the Matoa named Timmy to get.
And then they all drowned.
Named Timmy.
and then they all drowned. And the final picture is the spirits leaving the their body as they have. Die.
Final section. Well, not final. One of the final masks. They're masks. You know, it's very clear that a lot of them are supposed to be, like, interpretations, early concepts. I like how they have some of the masks with better hair.
It's like the first 3D models or something.
Better hair.
Yeah, like, some of these actually look like the crystal look they were supposed to convey, and not, like, the anime hair that they actually ended up looking like a lot of the time. So I appreciate that.
Still cool concept, but yeah.
Still cool concept. By far and above, my two favorite images from this whole section are the Mask of Control concept art pictures, simply because I've maintained all along, I still maintain that the final version of the Mask of Control was probably the worst interpretation of it, and I just really like how that looks a lot better, a lot more.
Yeah, I like how the eyebrows kind of go up and almost look like horns in a way, or like...
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then, by far, best thing, all the Mask of Ultimate Power concepts, because there's a heck of a lot of them.
Mm-hmm.
And it was called initially, if I found this out, the Death Crown.
That sounds so cool.
That sounds like an anime. Hashtag Death Crown.
Hashtag Death
Crown. Bionicle Death Crown.
Who needs Death Note when you have Death Crown?
Yeah, exactly.
And they clearly put a lot of thought into the moat, because they even have, like, concept art of it on the actual, like, set, how they would do a mask style like this, and they have an explanation for what I had thought before now was a really odd pronounced circle on the forehead of the actual final mask. Well, initially, it was supposed to be the method of attachment to, like, this new headpiece.
Because the mask was
so big, I guess it wasn't gonna fit on the actual headpiece.
I'm not a fan of.
Yeah, I'm not necessarily a fan of it, but it's rather clever.
It's a cool concept, Yeah.
I can understand the challenge of making a mask that big and having it fit on the actual head, which we know was a challenge because the eye holes don't line up.
Yeah, I mean, that's really the big thing here, is that the eye holes would not have, with all the designs that they were trying to do, it wouldn't have worked with the current headpiece that they had.
I'm the eye holes man.
Right, it does make sense in retrospect, but, you know, you're not a fan of it. Just even the idea.
I also see there was a campaign. There was a couple requests to get Cyberhand to like.
Wait! Wait a minute! Wait a minute!
He said no. What?
On the death crown concept. What it looks like? It's two masks. There's the actual death crown mask. There's the connector that puts the death crown mask onto the new headpiece. But the new headpiece has those little side attachments on the back of it. That headpiece attaches to the old headpiece. It's like a converter.
Yeah, right. I see. Right. Okay, that's better. That's much better.
Perplexing.
I can deal with that.
Seems like a lot of... It's very unfortunate. A lot of work went into this mask that it never actually got to see the light of day.
I'm looking at the stuff now. It's like... Some of the stuff is like, it's cool... And I get when they thought about it, they're like, this might be cool. And like the rainbow colors going around, that's a cool concept.
Yeah, I'm so glad that picture is in here because I had thought that they maybe wanted to do something like that, but it obviously wouldn't work in the actual set because people would hate how that looked. Yeah. But I appreciate that was a thought that they had because it is a cool idea.
One thing I don't really understand about the colors, though, is that, like, why are there two different types of brown? Like... I get one of them is technically supposed to be ice, but, like, ice has been associated with, like, the light blue. Weird.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. The coloration's a little weird.
No, the light blue is ice. The other one's dirty water.
Or maybe one's dirty ice. You don't know. They're kind of the same thing.
But it's like maybe these six colors are being used for every single, like, multicolor one, so...
Right below the multicolored section, we get a row of pictures that have, like, the mope as it kind of goes through different iterations, almost with different elemental themes to it. And it's fascinating because throughout the pictures, I can see how it evolved to what we ended up getting. And it's just, like, it's just great.
I now have this sort of headcanon that, like, depending on how the mask is used or which... it has multiple powers and, like, shifts with the type of power it uses.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking like they brought someone on from Destiny.
I would not have been surprised if one of the original concepts was that in the final year of Bionicle, the mask, like, each Bionicle set comes with a separate mask, you know? It's like there's the golden one and everything. If the mask this time was going to be the mask of ultimate power with an elemental style to, like, whatever Killua it was. So with Lila, it would have a jungle style to the mask of ultimate power. Mm-hmm. And then the final one would be released with the Makuta set.
That would be... very interesting.
Because from these concepts, you're right. It does look like they're trying to do... There's like an earth one, there's a water one, there's a fire one, there's a jungle one. It does look like they're trying to tie that in. So that would have been a really cool idea, is to have like different styles, you know, to show different powers. Or not even just styles, totally, but like maybe one that has like, you know, like the protector mask has different colors. Same thing. It would be like with a trans orange or trans blue or trans whatever.
It morphs with the wearer, maybe.
Morphs with the wearer, yeah. Or whatever element the wearer is using. So if you got all the Toa and you got the Makuta set, you could have him, like, you know, using jungle powers and then using, you know, all that stuff.
I'm sad we don't get a Makuta set now. Now that I kind of made the revelation of how the mask would have attached to it, I'm, like, really bummed. That would have been really cool.
Come on, 3D artists, do something.
As we scroll down, we get into the design section, and that one's probably the least interesting for me. It's concept art from the animations and Journey to One, but there are a couple gems in there, like this concept comic, which shows off a ton of interesting stuff, namely the Avoki, the island of Mata Nui, some kind of Boneheads of Voodoo Island-looking freak show monstrosity that comes out of the ground. There's all kinds of cool stuff here. This is clearly from the very early stages.
Yeah. One thing that kind of annoys me, though, is that on the page directly above it, how they have, like, storyboard concepts and stuff, everything looks really blurry. And I don't know if it's, like, just the coloring style or what, or if they, like, intentionally blurred it out. But
it's coloring and lighting concepts. That's what it is.
So whenever people do, like, 2D animation, they do a base thing, right? Where they
have, like, color model scripts.
Right, and then they apply the lighting and stuff on top of it. So you can, if you go and see the screenshots from the actual thing, there is lighting applied to all the characters.
Yeah, because it's animation, they don't have, like, a cinematographer, really, to, like, be able to sort out the lighting and everything to figure out how the shot's supposed to be composed.
Yeah, I know that, but it just looks like they took, like, a motion blur filter to everything.
That is true.
They basically did.
It is, whatever reason, like, these do look a bit lower quality. And I don't know if it's because of the, you know, how it was made or something. I do, honestly, looking back at the animations, and especially screen grabs from the animations with, like, you know, the backgrounds and stuff, I do like that style. I don't hate it or anything. I think it's a really cool style that they used. If it had been used in conjunction with more things, I feel like it really could have been.
And I love the animation style of the 2015 stuff to death. It looks so good. Both the animations and Journey to One. Phenomenal stuff.
They were really good in terms of art style.
I love this poster where they have, like, Ty's prototype mask juxtaposed against the silhouette of him on the lava board. I wish we'd gotten posters like that for all the time.
It just looks like he's floating in the air. Just, like, above a volcano.
Interesting
and then,
logo.
They actually included in here, they included some visual Journey concept art, just kind of showing the initial part of the story. But then they also included almost all of the comics from the 2016 wave of sets, where they had those little comics in the box featuring, like, Umarak going after the Mask of Control, so that's pretty cool. And then, to cap off the art book, some Journey to One concept art, which is no less cool.
Before moving on to the Journey to One real quick, I don't know if you guys noticed, but in one of the concept pictures for the Bionicle animations, it actually features that original Kanoe Howl that we saw back in 2014. That was on all the concepts, and then they changed it, and we were like, why would they change it? The last one was perfect. This one looks way less like a howl. But it's interesting to note, it's basically the same mask. It's just a different angle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's just the vents.
The vents were the only thing that changed.
Oh my gosh.
Remember how much crap the Bionicle team got for that?
I know, right? Oh, man.
I remember.
It's literally like...
Oh, that picture is really blurry compared to the one on the book. Is that like how it is in the actual PDF? The one that you linked?
It's very small.
Yeah, it's a very small in the actual PDF.
Okay. Well, it's really clear in the book, so it's like I can see it's literally the same mask other than the vents.
Okay.
Nice.
It's hilarious.
Wow.
That is pretty funny, like, all things considered.
We got some nice concept art for Journey to One. We got the Mask Maker City. Well, not the Mask Maker City. The Capital City pre-destruction, which looks incredible. Whatever the heck the Stone Pohatu was supposed to be, I still don't know.
That was...
this day.
That's...
Elemental,
like, armor, right? Didn't he actually have that in the show?
Yeah, he did, but I'm just saying they never explained what it was. But yeah, that was a thing.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Like the ninja unlocking their true potential just without an explanation.
Might have been just a hint that they... spoilers for J2O. Might have been just a hint that they were the elements the entire time.
Maybe, yeah.
A little bit of just...
I can see that.
Precursing.
And then, as much as I hate the fact that we never, you know, Makuta never got to fully emerge from the portal, there is that cool image of him with his shadowy, smoky face that I do quite enjoy.
It is pretty cool.
Mm-hmm. You can kind of see the Master Control on that one.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can.
Here's the one thing that gets me about these posters. So, finally, the two posters from Journey to One are down there.
Yes.
Really good posters. Except for one thing. The actual words, Journey to One. Who did that?
Yeah.
Who designed that? Literally anybody.
It's like somebody did it and says, Bionicle. Oh, wait.
There's
like
a title.
They sent it off, and then someone's like, guys, we don't have the title the thing on there. And someone's like,
and all
can
got
you open it
paint.
In Microsoft Word? Just open it in Microsoft Word.
I feel
Word
the same way about
over.
The actual title in the cards in the show as well. Like, the very low-res font choice.
Yeah, I don't know why they chose that font instead of, like, an actual epic font.
It really does look like something from Microsoft Word, doesn't it?
Doesn't it? Right? Like someone did Word art at the last second
because
they forgot?
It's like, let's use the one program that's not designed for image editing at all to edit our
code. Like, the first one, that red text ruins it. You can't even put like a white stroke behind it so we can actually see one or the bottom of Journey. It's just... I don't get that at all. As someone who's like, I'm not even a professional graphic designer. I literally just do things as a hobby. But like, that's just, I don't know. It gets to me a little bit.
Yeah.
I don't know. The posters are really well done though. Really.
And
really
then
good.
I don't know what this picture is supposed to represent. I can only
Stargate.
Imagine. I can only imagine it's supposed to represent the Shadow Realm coming into it because you can see the Mope sticker on the wall.
Sticker.
That looks really cool.
This is basically them going into the Nether. Is what.
Yeah.
I mean, I think this one's a really important image only because it's the very last image they have in the book. And it's also a full two-page image. Mm-hmm. So it's like...
I feel like this was one of the
it's also worth pointing out that in some of the villain concepts earlier, it specifically talks about demons.
Yeah. Mm. I feel like this is maybe our one 2017 piece of art that they were going to give us. Like what they had in
because
mind
to be fair,
forward.
We don't have any art of Makuta. That's a big factor here. That you know that they did more concept art of Makuta and maybe some more of Akimu. We don't really see
any there's
Akimu
zero
all,
Akimu and zero Makuta in this entire book.
Zero Mask of Time as well.
Temple of Time either.
Four people, I guess in retrospect.
I said the cover. There's Akimu on the cover before the comic.
Yeah, but Matt,
must I say,
Matt Bedecker made that drawing specifically for the book though.
Oh, I do really? Like how he has the front of Akimu on the front cover and the back of Akimu on the back cover.
Yeah.
Really, really, really cool.
Oh. Yeah.
That drawing was composed specifically for the cover of the book, so it's not actually a concept piece.
Okay.
In retrospect, the art book, if you are someone who wants to see a window into what Bionicle could be, wants to really enjoy some awesome art, a look at what might have been as far as set designs, the world, and all that stuff, you're going to love this art book. If you're someone who was hoping that this art book would answer all the burning questions about G2 and give us sneak peeks into the 2017 story and Makuta's set form and all this stuff, you'll be disappointed. And I'm glad that I didn't think that way. I didn't even think the 2017 stuff was a possibility until I saw one YouTube comment, just because it didn't seem likely, you know? And now that we've read the book, it makes perfect sense how it is. It wouldn't have fit in. Now, would I have liked to see some stuff? Certainly. But not how it is. Let's just enjoy what we have.
Yeah.
In closing, the Bionicle art book. What are our thoughts on it?
I love Matt Bedecker's style. I wish I could paint like that. Overall, everything else is like really cool too, but man.
Matt Bedecker. I mean, I believe Matt Bedecker is the senior artist, so it makes sense. Right.
Dude knows his stuff.
Yeah.
The thing that I would take away from this to the end, like, if I had to give a message to the LEGO team or something, the concept art you have here, all the world building stuff, that is what the fans, I feel, really wanted from this
line. Yeah.
And I feel like I would have been perfectly fine had you released concept art on the website with a little blurb about, you know, what it was. That would have helped me as a fan get connected to your world, get connected to your story, just by envisioning like where the characters live and the things that they're going through. And this style is amazing. It's everything I wish that we had for Bionicle in G1. I feel like this. This just like having things in this style. You know, I know he's a concept artist, but it would be. I mean, if you're just like, hey, you know, just draw like we have this for this year. Draw the characters just going to the Shadow Realm. Go draw the characters in this part of the world, and like put that up on your website. That stuff like that. That's what it would. That's all it would have taken for me, honestly. For me to start getting invested.
Because I mentioned earlier that Minog was, the only difference is that Minog was interactive.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, but like you said, they could have had text blurbs. It does seem like a little bit of a waste for him to have drawn these amazing artworks of the regions and the villages and whatnot. And like the website there, you know, we've talked just last week about how their time was spent writing up pointless text blurbs about stupid stuff that contradicts the story. How about combine your resources, use this amazing artwork, and use it as an avenue to placate the fans with world building?
If we had just gotten a new thing, like a paragraph about a new place, and just even if it wasn't showing up in the story, it's a new place in the world, like every month or so. Like, hey, today we're going to focus on the region of jungle. This is the city of blah blah blah, and you know the villagers do this.
The huts and the trees and stuff.
I would have bought into that so much as a fan.
That's the biggest reason why everyone who sees his art book and is disappointed because they feel like LEGO didn't love Bionicle. It's because this is a clear example of substance and everything that we are looking for that we never actually got. It's just it feels like there is this thing that this drive that the LEGO team, the Bionicle team, did have. They did actually come up with these ideas, but we never actually got to see them. And that's the biggest problem when it came to the world building of Bionicle. It was there, but we had no clue it was there.
The world is so much different in Bionicle than it is from any other LEGO line, I feel. Because in most other LEGO lines, it's the characters, it's the sets that really, like, people gravitate towards. You know, for space, you know, it's people love the space sets, but they love the space sets. You know, for Ninjago, I feel a lot of people really love the characters in that. You know, they love the characters and the arcs they go through and all that stuff. But for Bionicle fans specifically, we are in love with the world. The world is what makes it so real for us. It's what made it real in 2001. It's what made it real up until 2003. everything beyond that, and I feel it's what made it not real and what it failed later on, going down the line, is because we didn't get the same amount of exposition on the world that we needed. Bionicle, like, you know, the fans who do the projects and the you know, the mocks and the fan fiction and the art, we need
unlimited
the
freedom.
World. We need the world to, like, give us that context, you know, and that's what we love about Bionicle. I feel more than anything else. The sets are great, you know, and this, you know, the, and being all, having all these parts and stuff is also great. But this is what makes Bionicle for so many people. And yeah, I feel that sentiment is going to be heard around the fan base as this art book gets circulated more and more.
Yeah, and kind of going off of what you just said, is like, when you look at other themes like space or city or stuff like that, it's like, those are all in settings that we're already very familiar with. You know, we don't need to learn anything new about outer space or, you know, what a big city is like. Bionicle Bionicle does not take place in any common everyday area. You know, it's not just any old jungle or any old city or any old volcano. They're very Bionicle-esque specific things about these areas, these locations. So we need that context.
It's not like we haven't seen robots. We see robots all the time. That's what I didn't get into Hero Factory for, because I see robots, like, you know, everywhere. You know, robots are in Transformers. Robots are in, there's so many other lines. What Bionicle has different is that it's robots in this tribal setting, and it merges the two. And it merges the two in a very, 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 very unique way you don't see anywhere else. And that atmosphere is what drew me to it.
And we only got always half drawn me of to it. It.
And we kind of only got half of it. And now I'm looking at this art book, and I'm like, all right, so you guys did have, like, you knew what you were going through. And it was just a, and I know, you know, it's beyond your control in terms of, like, I'm talking to Bionicle team. But, like, you know, in terms of, like, what Bionicle fans want to see going forward, this is what we want to
the
see.
The book
and
is, the stuff right
the book
here.
Is what
this
we
is
see,
what we
right
want
here.
To see.
And I mean, social media, I mean, I'm telling you, that's the way that you get some stuff out about the story now, is through
just
social media. This is
trash
a perfect
cans.
Way.
This, not I mean, with like, trash cans. Yeah, no trash cans, please.
It was some marketing thing, and I understand that, like, it was an idea and it went somewhere and stuff. We need not to see best. More stuff like this. This is what keeps us going.
Yeah.
This is the substance we're looking for.
This is it.
I hate to encourage, like, a G3, like, official G3 or anything of the kind, because I really don't want one, considering what's happened. But if we were to give feedback
hold up.
Future for any other theme, learn from this.
Okay, now that you've seen the art book, do you really not want a G3, or you just don't want it to be handled the same way that G2 was? If LEGO came back and said, okay, guys, we understand now. We're going to go, you know, we're going all into this.
If they bring it back, they need to put all faith in it. And if that...
I was avoiding, like, that discussion because I wanted to, like, end this on a positive note.
Okay, I'm sorry.
That's, I mean, I'm a citizen.
Don't be sorry. You had no way of knowing. But, like, you want me to answer honestly? I don't have any confidence. My faith and my trust was shattered by G2. I don't believe that LEGO, unless they have a radical change in their business strategy, which I doubt they will,
they
because
have a new
they're
CEO.
Rolling in the dough. They're rolling in the dough because of their movies right now. I don't think that they have any desire whatsoever to treat Bionicle properly, not because they don't like it or don't because they don't value the fans, but simply because all the effort that it would take put into making Bionicle great to net the measly return that Construction actually gives could be put towards their other themes, which are infinitely more profitable.
I don't want G3 back because I don't think I could deal with another X, Y, and Z years of coming onto the podcast every week and Meso bagging on it.
Well, I mean, okay. Yeah,
I don't think I could deal with another X, Y, Z years of media.
Oh my God.
If I have to say. Yeah, okay. Come on, Meso. No, but for real,
I'm
though.
I'm joking.
Honestly, though.
I'm not.
I know you're not joking. For me, my thing is that, like, I'm seeing the same thing you are, but I've come to a different conclusion. I think that the movies, LEGO's rolling in the dough because of the movies, and they're wanting to get more story-based stuff because now they realize if we have a good story, we can also spin that into a good movie. And I hate to say that because I don't want – fans are going to be like, yes, the Bionicle movie, that's confirmed. You know, like, we should bring back Bionicle for a movie. This is nowhere near anything confirmed or anything. This is just conjecture. I feel like LEGO right now has been, they've always been, LEGO makes sets, they don't make stories, LEGO makes toys, you know? They've never had a reason to create a good story.
But now they are making
stories. Now they're like, okay, well, even if we don't make toys, we can still make billions of dollars off our own original line for a movie. And if the Ninjago movie does well, that is a thing where they're like, okay, you know, we had to pay royalties to, like, you know, Warner Brothers for Batman and, you know, all the cameos and stuff in the LEGO movie. And obviously the LEGO Batman movie is going to be a licensed property.
Mm-hmm.
But LEGO Ninjago, that's their thing. They get to keep more royalties from that. They came up with that by themselves. So if they're like, okay, well, Lego Ninjago is for the kids. Maybe we can get a more teen adult, not teen adult movie, but kind of a deeper-ish story. We don't need, the toys can sell well, but the movie ends up making the toys sell better. We saw that with the Lego movie. We can still make $1 billion. Not $1 billion. I'm sorry.
Come on, Lego.
We make a bunch of money off the movie and then, reap the benefit with the toys.
Become the next Marvel Comics. We need that Lego cinematic universe.
They do have a reason to do stories now. That's all I'm saying. They have a reason to do their own original stories and do them really well.
I would have loved to think, and in a lot of ways, Ninjago is a benchmark for Lego going forward. It's become so massively successful. It could be a trendsetter. Certainly, the show, the movie, going forward, if the movie does well, you're totally right. It's an original theme. But I already thought that. I thought that the success of Ninjago in its TV show format would have been a benchmark to go by for story-driven themes going forward. I thought that anything Lego did, they would apply the same principles that made Ninjago so successful to it. But they didn't for Bionicle. They did not give it a fraction.
It could have been. Well, we do know there's a lot of budget stuff going on behind the scenes.
But the budget stuff is part of the problem.
It is part of the problem. I feel like, all right, they launched it in a time where they were not expecting. The Lego movie did offset a lot of things. They were not expecting the boom the way that it did. I would say if I was an executive looking at Lego, and 2015 is already come and gone, and we're looking towards doing something, in the future, and I said, well, you know what? Let's take a current look at all of our story themes. What do we have now? We have Ninjago, we have Chima, we have Next Knights, we have Bionicle, we have Hero Actory, which was co-opted for a movie by Universal a while back. We're like, okay, what can we do? What kind of, what can we do with all these themes? And someone's like, hey, the Bionicle theme has had a lot of traction in the past, very nostalgic base. Everyone loves nostalgic stuff. Everyone's pulling back, all old toys are making
Transformers
movies now. Max Steel?
Yep. Steel.
Max Steel, whatever. They're wanting to make franchise of all the old movies came out in the 2000s or old toy lines. And they're like, all right, but we have it out right now. It's not selling well. We don't have a lot of, factory room for it. Also, I feel like the fan base isn't connecting with it. There's a lot of complaints with them. There's a lot of doing it. As an executive, my thing would be, okay, can we redo it? Can we just scrap it? Can we just cut it out and we'll do it maybe later down the line when we're thinking of co-opting it for a movie or something? If this is already getting negative stuff and we can't redeem it, let's just, right now, let's do it. We need the factory space.
That was a common theory when they announced the ending of Legos.
And again,
taking it off shelves just like they did initially in G1 to preserve.
Hate to say this because I'm afraid people are going to latch onto it and be like, this, yes, Bionicle's coming back from the movie. Lego made a comment and said, oh, we'll see. And we're like, that's confirmed. Bionicle's coming back for 2017. It's like, I hate saying this, basically.
It makes sense. Lego recognizes the value of the Bionicle theme. We know that because basically as soon as they ended it the first time, they went back to work retooling it. We now know the dates of concept art and planning and stuff. It was almost immediate. HF barely had a year, 2 years of life before they were like, hey, let's start talking about bringing Bionicle back. So they clearly do understand how much people love it. It would take the perfect set of circumstances. Bionicle G1 was lightning in a bottle. It came at the right place at the right time. It needs to happen again. And I can't honestly say I'm confident in those circumstances presenting themselves. Nor do I particularly want to have this whole, rigmarole of the back and forth of emotions, the ebb and flow of positivity, negativity. Just leave it in the hands.
I was kind of scorned by this entire experience, so it's I'd rather not go through it again. Plus, I don't know if the Ninjago movie or the Lego movie is going to be a real good indicator of what could work for Bionicle, because unfortunately, Ninjago kind of fits the mold of a Lego movie style.
Yeah, the comedy kind of
Bionicle does not quite fit that mold.
Bionicle's more serious.
Bionicle needs to be system.
Yeah. Bionicle does need. I honestly, I truly feel
if
like
Bionicle
they
came back as a system theme, my tune would change completely.
Brought it back as a system theme, I probably wouldn't buy any sets. Not gonna lie.
Agreed,
I would buy every single I would.
Honestly, I'm kind of back in the system.
I don't buy system sets because they're so expensive that won't change, but I will agree that it would be successful.
Well, it's hard for me to say because I do like Construction. I have a lot of great memories of Construction stuff, but the property Bionicle is not limited to Construction. The property Bionicle is a
they could do both.
Feeling.
They've already done that with Hero Factory and not so much Hero Factory, but Chima at the very least they've done that with.
Chima
and Star Wars.
And Star Wars. Exactly, and Star Wars. I don't see why they couldn't do the same with Bionicle. Have both.
That would be, you know what, honestly, that I would be okay with them, yeah. Just do the Toa. Just do the Toa every year's construction and give us like actual system sets. That would be the best compromise.
Because construction is a noose around its neck, not because it's a bad system, but because it has this predisposition of being this certain kind of a thing that isn't warranting a large budget or a large focus or a large marketing push or anything. And it's not because a lot of people inaccurately view it as being not real Lego.
I do feel like with the concept art does prove that Bionicle would probably work better as a movie than just a toy theme. Like something.
Well, maybe more a TV show, so it's not constrained to a couple hour time slot.
Yeah. Sure.
Journey to One is a step in the right direction. If anything, like the Netflix show. I mean, we know now.
It really was. Honestly, it was. I wish they put more into it.
One of the big things that just got released was Trollhunters. Trollhunters is, I forget to say his first name. Guillermo del Toro? What's his first name?
Guillermo del Toro.
He did a show with the Hickman brothers called Trollhunters, and they've been tweeting about it a lot. And,
never heard of it.
I haven't seen it yet, but it's been getting a lot of rave reviews and stuff on Netflix. And it is a thing that, like, once Netflix attaches onto something that they want to promote, you get that promotion, you know. You see that all over the place. I would love to see that come back in a certain way, you know. Get that. People know Bionicle memes. Bionicle memes happened this year. Forgot about that. Bionicle.
Yep.
Bionicle was the most popular it's ever been after it died because someone and me IRL on Reddit decided to do like a Bionicle, and Bionicle memes went everywhere. Discord did a stupid hoodie thing using Bionicle.
It was pretty surreal.
That was the most surreal thing of Bionicle that happened this year for me. Is like, oh wow, people, everyone knows Bionicle. It's way more popular. Totally than
everyone knows
the advertising
one
they got,
anyway.
But
right.
Yeah. That is probably gonna be where we leave it. To be completely honest,
yeah.
If there was a place to leave it for the year of 2016, I am glad it was this art book. Because this is something that fans are going to be able to latch onto for basically years to come. There's a treasure trove of ideas in here. Takuma was like inspired to write G2 fan fiction based off this alone. I can already see people talking in the
there you go, right
there. Let's have contests to make mocks of the characters that were shown in the art book. Eljay was saying, oh, not Eljay, Kai was saying, let's do creature contests.
Exactly.
Make like three creatures in one. Yeah. There's locations for world building. There's cool concepts for the story. There's all sorts of stuff which can come from this. Let's be heartened by that going into the new year.
Bionicle team, if you're watching this, just know that now people want to make fan fiction of your story.
Yep.
Now, with this book. Yeah. That's an important thing. This is what we needed at the very start.
So whether Bionicle comes back in the future, or whether there's a new construction theme, or even just for your system themes, use this knowledge, use this learning experience, and grow from it, and move to bigger and better things in the future.
And for the fans, man, you got this whole book of inspiration of what to do next. You know, like what you want to build, what you want to see. Now you have it. You have this whole, like, this wealth of tons of concept art that you can draw.
I want
from.
Someone to make Umarak the Octopus Man.
My mouth is literally watering. I'm not even exaggerating.
That's disgusting.
I'm not looking at food, but my mouth is watering.
No one would be the first to eat it.
The ideas, they're so great.
So thirsty for those ideas, though.
Yep. So, unfortunately, because of this art book talk, no room for G3 discussion.
We talked a bit about G3. We talked about what we would want to see. It's a system line plus contraction. So
reoccurring
theme. We kind of did get that.
You know, for as long as this one has been, it has not felt that long.
No.
And usually that doesn't happen.
This has been really fun.
Before I end and do our plugs for the day, any final thoughts on the art book? Last call.
Or just
it's
2016
really cool.
In general.
That's not. If only it came out earlier.
Last thing I have to say is that I feel like this is the one piece of Bionicle thing that I've received from the past 2 years that actually felt like it was straight from the Bionicle team. Never had to go through Lego at all. And this is just, it feels like a book filled with just
pure,
love, an awesome.
Pure, unadulterated Bionicle
this is,
joy.
Yeah.
This is
the Bionicle that we wanted.
This is what I remember from my childhood. This is like this thing of inspiration going through me, like, this is cool. I wonder if I could do this. I wonder if we could write about this. That is what I remember most about my childhood. That's what drew me here.
Everything in this book, this is what Bionicle was to me. So I'm glad that we finally got it. So
yeah.
Really happy about it.
Yeah. And if I had a request for like our community, to like, there's a bunch of ideas, but the one I want to see realized in some way, be it mocks or stories or art or like a game or whatever it takes, I want to see this idea coming up on screen right now, the Genesis thing. I want people to do something with that because that's cool to me. The Beyblade creatures.
Make a new comic series about it.
Comic series, yeah, whatever it takes. That's a neat spin on Bionicle. So
yeah, this is a cool art book. I'm glad that we got it. I'm glad we got to see it. Var, I'm glad that you got a physical copy, so at least someone here did.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I am quite happy about
that. I'm glad that LEGO went through the effort, as struggling and tiresome as it may have been, to actually get it done. We do appreciate it as little as we actually show it. And speaking of showing appreciation, come on, guys. Everyone in the community, listen. Generation 2 was not perfect. It wasn't great for everyone. Not everyone enjoyed it. A lot of people really liked Generation 1 more. That's fine. But we gotta get over it at some point. I maintain, if Generation 3 is a thing, I probably won't be on this podcast if Meso's gonna be here for it. Because I'm serious. That was the single worst thing I personally felt about Generation 2, was the drag down and the negativity. And now it's over. Generation 2 is done. Let's move on.
It's a new year.
Yeah, the new year is here. Let's move on to something
exciting. I feel like you
slipped
that in right at the end, but like there's room for discussion.
Well, there is.
Let's not.
And we can discuss it, but the main point is, let's just start over and move on and make the best of everything we had.
Please,
this
stop
is the 10-year anniversary of 2007. Let's do something with that.
No, like, let's stop attacking people for stuff. Bionicle team, you know, we're like, yeah, the company, whatever. But like, people are talking
Meso,
about like,
whatever.
Meso too. It's like,
he said people.
You know, people did their best, and sometimes we don't know the extent of that.
Yep.
Like Meso. Meso did his best to encourage discussion.
My commentary can only be as good as the source material.
Okay. I threw a bone.
All right,
I tried, man. Yeah. I was like, listen, I'm trying to help
you.
Well,
no, it's like,
I'm trying to.
I don't want the help. I maintain. I do not apologize for anything I said.
I mean, you can just kind of be like, if I
ever came out as harsh or, you know, whatever, it's because I care.
That wasn't meant to be a dig
because,
at you.
You know who else cares? Our Patreons. Yeah. What,
No, I agree with the spirit of moving on. I'm looking forward to the things we get in the future. All right, that was a mega length podcast, almost 2 hours long. Part of me kind of wants to stretch it to 2 hours, but the other
part of me is not going to work.
So,
thank you all very much for following us throughout the year of 2016 and all of Bionicle Gen 2, and 2017 is hopefully going to be a much better year. If you want to support us and you want to get some cool perks, check us out on Patreon at patreon.com/thetTVchannel. We recently added a whole new list of perks. And as per usual, every week we do our usual Patreon member shout-out. If you don't know what this is, it's basically because like we can't shout-out everybody. There's going to be like a text scroll going across the screen. But every week we pick one random person from our Patreon and give them a cool little on-air mention. So, this week, our Patreon will be, drum roll as I load up Patreon, which is loading incredibly slowly to pick a random person.
Wow.
Well, it's not loading whatsoever.
Here.
It's really not loading whatsoever.
Do this one.
Okay. Someone else do it. Let's pick a Patreon.
All right. For this week, our patron is Liam Quick, otherwise known as LQ1998. Yay!
Yay! You're famous.
He is a recognizable I wonder how old he is.
No clue.
Yeah, and why did they think that 1998 was such low quality?
Wow.
He's our patron. You shouldn't make fun of that.
Thank you very much
all
for your
patrons
support.
Are high quality to us.
Yeah.
HD.
All right. And if you want to discuss this art book and Bionicle in general and anything else your heart desires, check within the message board rules, of course, board.ttvchannel.com for fun times all around. That's basically that. So, farewell, everybody, and we will see you all for the new year.
Bye-bye. I'm Var.
I'm at the LJ Johnson on Twitter. I'm LJ.
I'm Jonathan.
I'm Takuma Nuva.
I'm Prpl.
And I'm Tenebrae Invictus.
And this was TTV episode 228. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Bye. Bye.